I want you to close your eyes and picture something with me for a second. Come on, close them. It's September 1999. The air is brisk, with dog days nearing their end, as I'm driven by my mum to a new elementary school to continue my second month of first grade. I enter the new, staggeringly spotless computer lab at my school, and my eyes glisten with excitement upon seeing the entirely fictitious Power Mac G4, because this entire story is made up. I press power, hear the famous Macintosh boot chime, and realize this computer is going to change everything. Open your eyes. There's a lot of hubbub about Apple ditching Intel and the x86 platform in favor of ARM, which is the instruction set that Apple has been using on iPhone, iPad, Apple Watch, and Apple TV since inception. Okay, well, the first Apple TV wasn't technically ARM, but we don't talk about that. Or should we talk about that? I still have mine from 2007. Let me know down in the comments below if you want to see a video on that. It was a disaster. But with this rumored transition to ARM on Mac, Apple would presumably develop processors just like the iPhone's A-series chips, but specific to the Mac. Now, I think a lot of people kind of believe that, perhaps rightly so, Apple's innovation has flattened out over the last few years, or that they're just not trying anymore. But do you know what? This isn't new. People said the very same thing about Apple in the early 90s, but Apple proved them crazy wrong by developing the fastest home computer on the planet that absolutely crushed any Windows Intel machine from the era. You see, back in 1991 to about 1993, Apple's chip architecture, which had been in use since the original 1984 Macintosh, was really aging rapidly. Their Macintosh lineup was still wicked fast and was running on the 68K family of microprocessors by Motorola, but they were becoming bulkier, hotter, and more expensive than ever before. Apple was trying to squeeze as much processing power out of the old technology as humanly possible, and it showed. Wintel computers, that's Windows Intel computer, by the way, were less expensive, they were far more efficient, they didn't run as hot, and they were really catching up in the speed department. Then Apple CEO John Sculley had commissioned an internal project called Jaguar to develop a new 4-core RISC-based CPU designed to succeed the Motorola 68K chips. But what this would mean was that there would be no backwards compatibility for old software. And Apple just didn't have the market share in that time to force people into a new machine platform. They'd have created a platform that was basically dead before it was born. And in the 80s, Steve Jobs had already made that error with the Lisa, an insanely powerful computer that was made useless due to the lack of software. Luckily, a veteran engineer at Apple, Jack McHenry, saw the new incompatible computer was just doomed to fail from the start and developed the Cognac team at Apple. Long story short, and it really is a very cool story, McHenry's team developed a RISC-based machine that was able to run old Macintosh 68K software with essentially full compatibility, thanks to an incredible hypervisor emulator. It was one of the first computers ever to do this, by the way. And the PowerPC platform was born. For over 10 years, Apple was making hardware with an extensive software library that absolutely obliterated any Wintel machine in its path. In fact, that 1999 G4 I mentioned at the beginning of the video was the first personal computer with a gigaflop of performance. And it made such a mockery of Intel's Pentium 3 system in terms of like operation at over 2x the speed in most workloads that it was actually less expensive to own and operate a Mac than even the best Intel PCs at a time. Suck it, PCMR. But the PowerPC architecture, like the 68K platform before it, eventually met its demise. And Apple.
And so it's time for a third transition, and yes, it's true. We are going to begin the transition from the PowerPC to Intel processors, and we are going to begin it for you now and for our customers next year.
Intel CPUs were just more efficient per watt, they ran cooler than the PowerPC, and they showed far more forward-facing potential. And moving to Intel was really a good move for a number of reasons. Sharing an x86 platform between Windows and Mac made apps much more easy to port between systems, allowed Mac to run Windows natively through boot camp, and then permitted the Mac to integrate into the business and enterprise market for really the first time ever. It allowed for increased system stability and more. But it also came with some huge drawbacks. Apple's hardware advantage that existed with the PowerPC was gone. Apple was a systems builder. They were a hardware company, and moving to off-the-shelf parts from other companies limited Apple's design capabilities. It required that all the performance benefits of a Mac be done in software optimization, since the hardware was more or less the same as everything else on the market. The Hackintosh market was born and flourished with reverse-engineered and custom EFI kernels, and the Mac became beholden to Intel's update cycle. So back to ARM. Why would Apple care? And why would they move to it? And why should you care? And why will you move to it? Well, there's a number of reasons. Number one, Apple can continue its quest of vertical integration and supply chain control. Apple's not going to be waiting on Intel to release new products, and we won't be waiting on Apple to integrate those new Intel products. Number two, it allows Apple to have a unique market offering. Look, nobody else, at least not for a while, will be making flagship ARM computers. Microsoft has kind of attempted on the low end, but unsuccessfully, in part because Microsoft requires backwards compatibility and enterprise support, both of which Apple has historically disregarded. Number three, unit cost decreases. Intel is a ripoff because they own an essential monopoly on the market. And while AMD is catching up and giving them a run for the money in the consumer base, they're still the de facto supplier of enterprise hardware, and their prices, well, they kind of reflect that. The trade price of that dinky little 8-core Xeon in the new Mac Pro is $749. That is insane. In theory, Apple could reduce the price of their machines and become cost competitive with low-margin PC manufacturers, but with much higher performing and much higher quality hardware. Now, would modern Apple do that? I hope so, but they might just maintain pricing and increase their margins. Number four, the hardware may truly be better. If Apple Silicon is anything to go off of, they've demonstrated extreme proficiency in chip design. And they continue to hire some of the best SoC engineers in the world. And I don't think that's a coincidence. Now, don't expect a complete transition to happen on day one. Steve Jobs said in the 2005 Macworld keynote that moving from PowerPC to Intel would take a few years. And Apple actually got it done faster than expected. But I would expect the same for ARM Macs. This new Catalyst project, which ports iOS ARM apps to x86 Mac apps, is a great way for Apple to test emulation and app compiling. And it allows app developers to get comfortable with Apple's Swift coding language. It also allows customers to run most of the software that will be available on ARM Macs on their x86 computers while we wait for a couple years as there's a smooth transition of power to the ARM platform. Number five, it will pretty much kill off Hackintosh computers, even though Apple probably doesn't really care about that as much as most people think they do. Number six, in theory, it will allow for much better battery life, as RISC-based systems will be more efficient and generate less heat. Maybe we can finally say goodbye to thermal throttling on Apple computers. Then again, maybe they'll just make their computers thinner again. Number seven, there are potentially massive security benefits. And number eight, there could be multi-app platform purchasing, since the OSs will share similar code bases, near identical, actually. So you could buy an app on your iPhone, and it works on your iPad and on your Mac as well. And if all these platforms are easy to develop for, the number of quality apps on the Mac should skyrocket. And I could go on. But that's not to say that this thing doesn't have potential downsides, because it absolutely does. This is a huge gamble for Apple, with exponential increases in research and development, with no guarantee for return. And really, at the end of the day, Apple's a corporation, and it's liable to its shareholders. They will have to maintain a competitive advantage on x86 and Windows ARM machines as they become available. They're going to have to continue for years to come, and they can't just rely on Intel to do the heavy lifting for them anymore. Apple may also erroneously seek power over compatibility, like they've done in the past. And if the Catalyst transition isn't a smooth one, things might be really buggy for a number of years, decreasing the overall customer experience. But you see, I think this future is brighter than it is dull. And I hope that Apple can ditch the those are really high-end special effects, we know. And I hope that Apple can ditch the often accurate stigma that they've just become anti-consumer, and that they're overpriced, and that they're incapable of innovating anymore. There are people out there that don't know that Apple used to make the fastest computers in the world. And as a lifelong Mac user, I'm really hoping Apple will finally live up to Phil Schiller's famously smug and unfulfilled words.
Can't innovate anymore, my ass.